Well, good morning. Hopefully it'll start ringing in a second. First, I give honor to God, who is ahead of my life, to my pastor, to my co-pastor, to all the saints, all the ministers, all our friends, to my wife and my children, and to everyone. We count it a blessing to be before you again, to share what I know God gave to me. And I like how God works. Whenever, not that I had a doubt, but he always lets something be said that kind of confirmation of what he's given you. And so I was like, okay, God, thank you. So, and we should always be thankful for God, thankful to God when he gives us confirmation. And you say confirmation of what? And confirmation of what he's speaking to us, right? And because he's always speaking. He's always speaking. And with us understanding that he's always speaking, if we understand he's always speaking, we'll always have an ear to hear.
That's right.
But see, we have this, what the enemy has us sometimes distracted to think that God ain't always speaking. He's always speaking.
Yeah.
God is one of those ones that he always got something to say. He's one of those people that always got some better news for you.
Right.
Some better news for you. But what I realize is in order to hear that and to be in the right mindset to receive what he's saying all the time is we have to wake up in pursuit of our purpose.
Right.
In pursuit of our purpose. Today I'm going to talk to you, and the title of my message is Purpose Driven Daily.
All right, now.
Purpose Driven Daily. Purpose Driven Daily. What God began to show me is he said, we can't lose.
All right,
now. If we're purpose driven daily. If we're purpose-driven daily, we can't lose. Nothing can be withheld from us if we're purpose-driven daily.
Daily.
It's something we should, his purpose for our life should be the first thing on our mind when we hit the floor. When our eyes open, it should be, okay, God, what is it that you have for me on this day? What is it that you have for me to do on this day? I think a lot of times we have no problem with saying, God, what do you have for me on this day?
All right, now.
But when it comes to, God, what do you want to do through me on this day?
All right, now.
That becomes a little bit more harder to receive. Because that means you got to do something, and it ain't all about what he's going to do. What he began to tell me, he said, I've done enough already. If you really want to look at it, I've already done enough. I've done enough for you to get up pursuing my purpose.
Glory to God.
I've already done enough. But I'm willing to do more for you just because I love you,
yeah,
right?
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Just because I love you. Yeah. So we're going to go to, I want everybody to go to 2 Timothy, the first chapter, and we're going to start at verse 6. When you get there, say amen. Remember, today and from this day forward, our main focus should be our purpose. And through his ability, he's going to help me shed some light on how to stay in pursuit of that. Everybody there? In 2 Timothy, first chapter, verse 6, we go into verse 10. It says, wherefore I put thee in remembrance that thou stir up the gift of God, which is in thee by putting on of my hands. God began to tell me, he said, at this time, the apostle was talking about how he laid hands on him. And God began, he said, you know, now at this day and time, you have the ability to lay hands on yourself.
All right.
He said, because the same anointing that lied in the ones that came to lay hands, that the people didn't have that ability at the time. But we do, because it's in us.
Yeah.
The Christ that they had is within us.
Yeah.
So anything you need by the laying of your own hands. Because see, we need you to understand that your hands is just as powerful, or can be just as powerful as pastors. Right? Because so many times we think, I got to get the pastor. And if I get the pastor, he lay hands. And God is saying, well, what's wrong with you? I'm right here. I'm right here. I'm pretty sure all of us have some oil in our house. Why is it there? It's there for us to use. Where we can lay hands on the people in our home and on ourselves. He's trying to take all excuses away from us. Because he's saying, if you pursue purpose, nothing is impossible. Right? We're going to go to verse 7. It says, for God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and love and of a sound mind. Be not therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me in prison. But be thou partakers of the affliction of the gospel according to the power of God. Now, I like the fact that even in his state, he was saying, I ain't ashamed. I know what I stand for. I know who stands with me.
Yeah.
Right? And I like the fact that no longer can we be persecuted for what we believe, for pursuing the purpose of God. Right? It's illegal. They can't imprison us for going out preaching the gospel.
All right.
Not in this country. You should thank God for that. Yeah. You get to share your opinion. If somebody came and asked you, you don't have to hesitate on what you believe.
Yeah.
So why do we? So why do we hesitate on what we believe? We're talking about the purpose. Because what if in that moment, your purpose at that moment was to share the gospel? But you decided this ain't the time or the place. Right? But you could miss it. Right? But if you was up that morning asking God, what is it that you want to do through me on this day? When that time happens, something in you will rise up and say, it's time now.
Yeah.
This is the time that you're supposed to speak out for me. Right? You're supposed to speak out for me. Verse 9 says, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. So, the purpose that he has placed on your life was given to you before the world began, right? And it wasn't about how good you can be according to what purpose you got, right? It ain't according to the mistakes you made or the mistakes you didn't make, right? That determine the purpose. God's purpose never changes. No matter what you do, or no matter what I do, or no matter how many times I mess up, if I remain, my purpose still remains.
Right.
Right? So I should be in pursuit of how do I fix this? Because I should be driven daily by my purpose.
Yeah.
I should be driven daily by my purpose. But so many times we get caught up in thinking salvation was only there just to save me. But God has something for us to do. Salvation ain't just for you. It's for anybody that has an ear to hear. And I'm saying, how many people in my world have an ear to hear, but I'm not speaking? But I'm not saying anything. God placed them there for me to speak. For him, she talked about how grateful we should be that we're in this house, right? You're not in this house to receive all this word just for your own sake. We talk about his ministry is worldwide. How does it get to be worldwide? He never stops putting it out there. He talked to anybody who willing to listen. I know that because I've been around him. If it's just me, he gonna talk to just me. If it's just you, he gonna talk to just you. And he gonna give it to you until God tell him to stop. And you should be grateful for that. You shouldn't be sitting back saying, oh, my God, I wish Pastor would stop. But because evidently it's something you really, really need. Right? Because so many times, you know, when it comes to our purpose, we think our purpose is to come here to help him. Our purpose is attached to his purpose. But our purpose ain't here to come. And you know what? You can't do this without me. It's no, we can't do this without him. He's the shepherd, right? They're the shepherds. So anytime you get to sit before them and let them, you know, give you what God is speaking to them at that time about you and what can help you, it's all to develop your purpose more and more. Because remember, I told you, pursuing your purpose, if you in pursuit of your purpose, you can't lose. You can't lose. That's why no matter what you do or say or not do for them, you notice they purpose still a sword and it's getting bigger. And what God began to show me, he said every time somebody say something negative, he said, I enlarge their wings. That's what he told me. He said every time somebody say something to derail them or to try to distract them, the more they stay focused, the bigger their wings grow. Right? He said he can make them and make you adapt to whatever the situation may be, because he will always give you the ability to rise above it. Amen. If you choose to.
Glory to God.
But if your mind ain't on the purpose of why you there,
glory,
right?
Yeah.
You can run into these stumbling blocks that you can't soar over because your mindset is not in the right place.
All right.
Right? I'm worried about what she said or why she said it. My grandmother used to always tell me, it ain't what they call you, it's what you answer to. She said it ain't what they call you. They can say what they want, but until you give it light, he said, you make it look like it may just be you. Right? But he's saying, I will give you the ability to soar over anything that tries to hold you back. But the first thing, you got to be in pursuit of my purpose for your life. Nothing's more important in your life than his purpose.
Yeah.
Right? Amen. Because everything that you desire, believe it or not, is attached to your purpose. It's attached to it.
Glory to God.
You cannot not receive what's due to you. If you're pursuing your purpose.
That's right.
It's not possible.
That's right.
But he say we get it out of whack sometime and our eyes go more towards what we desire. And we put the purpose secondary. Because see, if I get this over here, then it becomes important. Because see, if I get this, now he proven to me that this is important. No, this is important. And he'll give you all this stuff. Right?
Yeah, yeah.
Did you hear the word? Give you all this stuff. A lot of times we put ourselves in our earning spot, right? Because we ain't pursuing his purpose, so we having to earn a whole lot of stuff that he just want to give to you. Right? We talking about things that he want to give, and we fight and struggle just to receive it when it's right there, but we got things out of whack, right? It's not in the right line. We don't have it on the right line. It ain't the title of your life. My purpose ain't the title of my life, right? My ministry, me as a prophetic gift, should be the title of my life, right? Not me as a personal trainer. That's secondary.
Yeah, yeah.
Believe it or not, me as a husband is secondary. Me as a father is secondary. And that you may think that don't sound right. Yes, it does. Because I can be the father and the husband that they need if I got my purpose in line. And it's the title.
Yeah.
Right? So salvation is only the beginning for Christians as we were saved to do good works in the name of Jesus Christ.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? The promise of eternity and living free from the bondage of sin is a wonderful gift of salvation.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But what we have to realize is don't get caught up in that. He said, free from bondage.
Mm-hmm.
We ain't supposed to keep, if he needs to, he can keep freeing us.
Mm-hmm.
He can keep, but some stuff we supposed to be free forever from. We supposed to be free forever from it, right? And if our purpose, I'm going to always go back to our purpose, because if we have our purpose in line, guess what? We're going to keep on going in and out of these same things that throws us off, that besets us. It ain't going to happen. Because some of this stuff, when I see it, he said, I will see it no more, right? He said we can come to a point where Eva come nigh your, will not even come near you.
Yeah.
It's like when that, when Eva sees you, it's like, that's the last place I want to go.
Yeah.
Because I already know my outcome. Because that person's focused over there.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
But let me go deal with these ones that ain't focused. These ones that seeking more of the carnal things, right? Instead of the spiritual things, right? Right? Okay. These promises, these promised blessings free us up to be about God's business every day.
Yes.
We need to start our mornings with a prayer asking God to reveal to us his purpose for that day.
Yes.
Right?
Every day.
I'm guilty of it not being every day. Because I can get busy, you know. I can get up and stuff on my mind and I'm going. And you know what? And we use that as an excuse. But guess what? That ain't an excuse.
That's right.
I need to put something that reminds me every single day that that's exactly what I should be asking for. Because I have this prayer that I pray every day. Okay, God, I don't know who it is that you will bring before me. I know the people you have I have scheduled. But if it's somebody else or even if it's them, help me to have the intelligence and the ability to share with them what I needed to be for them on that day.
Yes.
Right? I ought to know that if they come before me, God always has something to say.
Yes.
Always have something to say. If I got a scheduled appointment with Elder Coleman, right? I know for a fact that me and Elder Coleman may be meeting up because I want him to do something for me.
Mm-hmm.
But God says there's always something deeper attached.
Mm-hmm.
He may come over to measure my counter because I want him to change the bathroom because that's what he do and he's good at it. But I guarantee you, if me and Elder hang around each other long enough, God's purpose is going to start rising up out of each of us.
Yes.
And it's going to be something now that's supposed to help. But we come now with an empty mind, right? Not even thinking about, okay, God, what is it? What is it on this day? Why this person today? Right? I had the honor of having lunch with a special lady, right? And we met and ran into each other and said, she said, you want to go to lunch? I was like, yeah. I'm honored. So, but it wasn't long. I don't think it was within 5 minutes, within 2 minutes, soon as we sat down, because I know what she is in my life, and I'm willing to receive what she is in my life, right?
Mm-hmm.
I have no problem with what she is in my life.
Mm-hmm.
Did you hear what I have no problem. So I'm willing to receive whatever it is that she has for me, and it wasn't. The lady had to come back to the table a couple times. Y'all ready to order? Because it just started happening just like that. God's purpose, God's will, God reason. Okay, we there to eat. That's something we enjoy. But at the same time, it was something way deeper than that. It was so deep that after the lunch was over, we had to sit there and just keep going. Then we had to walk out in the parking lot, and it kept going. We had to sit and look at the time like, you know what? I need to let you go. Right? Because as long as we sat there and was willing to let him speak, he was going to do so.
Yes.
He was going to do so. But he does things decently and in order, right? So I got let go. She got let go right at the right time. We made it to wherever we need to make it to. But you know what? The whole key, I was so thankful that, you know what? I received so much out of just that.
Yes.
And I pray that she received something from me also.
Amen.
Right? That she received something from me also, because it wasn't just a lunch.
Yeah.
It was it's my first one, but it was, and I walked away like, you know what? That's something, because I told her, I said, well, I don't have that, you know, go to lunch with, you know, my mama type thing. So when I get to have lunch with my mother-in-law or my co-pastor, I think it's a big deal.
Yeah.
This me. I can't speak for nobody else, but it's a big deal to me, because I don't really have that. You know, I don't really have that where I can call and say, hey, I don't have that. But I do have it, because if I call my mother-in-law and say, you want to go to eat? She's going to be like, yeah. I know for a fact. God going to speak to her for me.
Yeah.
Right? So I was honored. So what we have to realize is we always should be pursuing what God has for us on that day. And for whoever it is. But see, so many times we go into this thing and it's like, he said we can even get it off balance when you think you're the only person that's supposed to be talking.
Come on, preacher.
Because this person, right? She's my co-pastor, right? She's my spiritual mother, amen. Right? But she said she received something from me, mm-hmm. right? Amen. That's honorable to me. Because God has something in me that she can receive. That's what I'm saying. If I came there and I came to and I had lunch with Kevin and Kevin's like my son and I go there and I think, you know what? Only thing supposed to be going on is I'm supposed to be telling him. I'm supposed to be helping him. Mm-hmm. It's something in Kevin that can help me. Yeah. Because God don't do give take relationships. He can have give. Yeah. It's a benefit to us all. If everybody's pursuing purpose. So imagine if everybody in this house is after the same pursuit of their purpose, right? And then we as a family blend together in this whole house, because what he began to tell me, he said, this is a house of purpose.
Yes, it is.
Because he started to talk to me about, he said, it's amazing how everybody come here, something's identified in them, and pastors start to pull on a ministry gift that's in them. And I had people ask, come here and visit. And they like, how many ministers do y'all have? You know, I done been to church and they have the assistant pastor and the pastor, and they have a deacon and they had it, and that's it. You come in. I came out on the first Sunday and the whole first three rows had collars on. What? And I'm saying, what we should be so honored is that our pastor would not let us sit dormant on our purpose. He won't let it happen. It irks him when you won't even take it serious. Because he be sitting there saying, man, I see so much in you and you don't even realize. You sitting there and God's showing him finished products, right? You know where they could be. And I'm tired of holding him up. You notice I ain't say you, I said me. I said I'm tired of holding him up. Because you know what? I'm up here doing this, but I can do more.
Glory to God.
I can be that magnifying glass in my own life. You can't, but I can. And I know in some areas that I can step up. So me, I'm pursuing purpose. I'm tired of him having to, he may not feel like that, but I know even with my relationship with him, my contact with him got to get better. That's me. I can't talk about y'all, but it's me. Me. I got to communicate with my pastor more often. It's going to happen. It's going to happen. I'm saying it before y'all as my witness. It's going to happen. I'm going to contact him more because I don't, not that I have a problem, but it's just needed. It's something that I'm missing because I'm not attaching myself like I should. Right? Like I should. Not that my pastor, I don't think he has a problem with me. I think we good. But it could be better. It could be better. And if we ain't pursuing, isn't that what we pursue in life, period, anyway? Better. I want better. That's what we say. Why do we pursue careers? Because I want better. I want better. I want more than what I have right now. Right? But why is it okay for you to want more of your career and more of your finance and more of all this, but you don't want more of your purpose? The whole reason why you even exist should be the first and foremost thing you want more of. Because if you get a hold of that, all that other stuff will be what? Added. Given to you. So if you're wondering why you're struggling in certain areas, maybe it's something that's you ain't supposed to be earning. Maybe it's something that you're supposed to sit back and do and get in line with the Spirit and get in line with God, and then he will just add that thing on. Because wait, when he say add on, this is what I look at. This is how I view it. And it made sense to me. Okay, if I'm in pursuit of it, right, I got to go search it out. I got to go find it. I got to figure out how to obtain it legally.
Yeah.
I gotta figure out how I'm not offending anybody. When I say legally, I ain't just talking about like, I'm talking about if I go grab something and I offend elder, that ain't legal.
All right now.
That's not legal. See, we take stuff so literal. You know, when I said legally, everybody looking at, oh, you might go to jail. No, I'm talking about I don't wanna get something and offend my brother. I want him to be happy. Because when he see me get it, he should, something on his list, he should say, you know what, mine on the way too, right? So with that being said, I'm sitting back and I'm like, hey, this is what we want to do. I want to, and so you have to go and you have to search it out and you have to find it, you have to figure out how to obtain it. Then once you get it, you have to figure out, okay, well, how I'm going to keep it from the people that want to take it from me, all this kind of stuff. This is all the mindset that you have to go through when you out searching for it. But he say if you stay focused, right? So think about it. My eyes is on my purpose. He said these things will be added unto me. So I look at it like a train, right? And the car is just being added. I'm staying focused. It's just getting added. And then I feel my load get a little heavy because that got some stuff back there, right? Then he enlarged me because I'm focused. He gonna give me the strength to do what I gotta do and to reach what I gotta reach, right? So then my locomotive started to pull a little harder, right? So because that stuff being added back there, right? Now before long, I gotta stop this caboose and look at what all he done added to me. But he don't want you focused on that. See, so many times I've never seen a train going like this. And the caboose of the train, the engine part of the train, is pushing the cart. I've never seen a train travel like that. Have you ever seen a train travel like that? It's pushing. No, it's always full steam ahead. Now, they can attach all the carts that they need, right? And if it get too heavy for one, I've seen they'll add another one. Because guess what? It ain't nothing but an engine. It ain't nothing but an engine. So now I need a second engine to pull all this stuff. Right? Turn around, Elder. So now me and Elder, we two locomotives. Now we two engines. Guess what now? We got to pull my stuff and his stuff.
Hallelujah.
It said one will chase 1,000, but two will chase 10,000, right?
Yep.
So that means his adding ain't like our adding.
I know.
So that means we got a whole lot
Come
of
on,
stuff
prophet.
Back there.
Come on.
We got so much stuff back there that we can stop this locomotive and say, you know what? You need something? You need something?
Yep,
Elder, I think we got it back there. Go back there and get it for us. All right, thank you, Elder. You see what I'm saying? See, when we pursuing our purpose, we ain't thinking about what we thinking about ourselves. I'm in pursuit because I want to be a blessing to somebody else. See, your purpose will keep you focused on blessing others. Because he said in his word, think not about what you may drink or what you may eat or what you may wear. Know why he don't want you thinking about that? Because you don't have to. You don't have to. You have no reason to. Because he has every single thing that you could ever desire sitting there waiting on you. I'm waiting on him to say, you know what, Trey? These are the things that I want you to pursue, and these are the things that I'm just going to give to you. I just want to know what that list looks like. I want to know, look, I'm even concerned about, God, what in the world have I earned that I didn't even have to? Because I don't want to make that mistake again. I don't want to make that mistake again. And you shouldn't either. But in order for us to stay focused, our purpose got to be the title of our life. We talking about purpose driven daily. Daily, not skip a day, not on Sunday. We go to church, so I got to get myself together and focus on what it is, God. And then people say, I pray for my purpose for the rest of the week. But you know what? It's a day. It's a daily walk. It's a daily walk. It's something we must pursue daily, right? Daily. Now, perfect purpose. The Lord and his purpose are perfect, but we are not, right? We get caught up in doubt and fears, right? We're going to talk about a couple of things that may kind of keep you from being able to focus on your purpose. But what I liked about the word is he got something for everything.
Yeah.
He got anything you could come up with or anything the devil can come up with to try to derail you. God got something in his word that would rectify that. Be like, what they talking about? That don't even make no sense.
Come on now.
Did you forget what I said? Did you forget what I said? And see, if we focus on our purpose gonna always draw us to the word.
That's right, amen.
Because we can't do the purpose without the word.
That's right.
Because we have to solidify our purpose with the word.
Right.
We have to back our purpose with the word.
Right.
It's almost like fuel for our purpose is in the word.
Right?
Amen. You can't drive your car without fuel. Right? So you have to go to the gas station to actually get gas to fill up your tank, to take you where you want to go. This is your gas tank. This is your gas station right here. Every single thing you need to fuel your purpose is right there. But we don't do what 2 Timothy 2:15 say. We don't study to show ourselves approved, right? A work that need not to be ashamed. Rightly divide the word. Right? That's important. It ain't just you read the word, you gotta understand it. Because it said rightly divide. If it say rightly divide, that means it's a possibility for it not to be rightly divided. And we all have heard it. Wrongly divided. We all have heard it. And it's funny because we've been places and pastor have taught us so well. That you will hear people say stuff and you hear everybody from right to go, Y'all, don't act like that ain't never. Y'all done heard it. Y'all done heard it. People be up there and you'll be with them. Like, yeah, they'll say something. You got to go through it. Then everybody drop their heads, don't look around. Right. Pastor Cosby sitting up there in the chair and then he do this right here over there. Make sure y'all, don't y'all.
Yeah.
Don't act up. Everybody don't get what you get, so don't do that. Don't do that. Because guess what? He understand we got a purpose for being there. And if we put ourselves so far above them just because we may understand something that they don't understand, it can deter them. Like, you know, them people came now and you see how they act when they said this or they said that. So you always gotta watch your reaction. If you gotta mumble it to yourself and say, I ain't receiving that. You know, I rebuke that. But you shouldn't be standing up to my, I ain't receiving that. Or tapping on the person next to you that ain't part of you. Talking about, don't believe that. That ain't true, child. That ain't true. That is not proper. That ain't proper. We got to do everything properly. Because what did I say? Legally. I said legally. Legally in the confounds of this is everything done in love and in righteousness. All things being done in love and in righteousness. So even if I got a correction for you, I need to bring it in love and in righteousness. If I ain't got a proper way to say it, I need to shut up.
Come on, preach up.
I need to keep my mouth closed. Because my purpose ain't going to make me offend somebody. And if I make a mistake and offend somebody, because my ear is keen to his word and to his voice, he's saying, you got to go back and fix that. And I got to let my pride go to the side and come up and say, if I did anything to offend you, I need to fix this. See, you may think we all over the place, but it all comes right back to your purpose. Right? We talking about you need to study to show, because he will give you the answer. He will give you the answer. So that our faith may be strong. This is why studying is so important. Where our faith will be strong day after day. Because the faith that you had yesterday won't work for today. It won't work for today. He want to fuel you on a daily basis. He want to fuel you daily. He never ever wants you not to be equipped with what you need.
That's right.
But so many times we go into a day not equipped. And it ain't his fault.
No.
It ain't his fault. Amen. It's our fault. We didn't properly prepare ourselves to face that day. People say, today just been a rough one. I wonder whose fault is that?
Come on now.
He said he always gives a way of escape. So no matter what that day brings before me, guess what? If I stay focused, he going to always have a way of escape for me. I tell people all the time, they say, you having a good day? I said, I refuse to have anything else. That's what I tell them. I refuse to have anything else. Because the only person that determines that is me. Right? If something come before me that I feel like may wreck my day, I can choose not to even go with that. Man, you know what? Not today. Not today. That don't go with the purpose that he had showed me for the day. I ain't going. You know what? That's something. That's a distraction. I ain't even worried about that. You know what? I'm not going to even give you that credibility. I ain't going to make you that important. Sometimes you have to, you may not say it to them, but you have to say it to yourself. They ain't that important. Not on this day. They can be important tomorrow, but if they bring in that negativity, not today. Not today. Not today. I'm not doing it today. Right? It says in Romans 10:17, it says, so then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So we got to get it together. Right? Now, some things that may get us a little off focus. Our past and things that we used to do that we deemed that disqualified us from his promises. So now I've had people say, you don't understand the life that I live. I understand I got to go through and I got to earn everything that I get right now. And my thing is, that's a sad thing to say for yourself. Because if you was focused on your purpose and you understood salvation, you would understand that those things has passed away. Right. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Yeah. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new. He said, old things have passed away, and behold, hold on to this. Hold on to this fact. Yeah. The fact of the matter is, all things have become new. Yeah. Right? Yeah. And if that wasn't good enough, Hebrews 8:12 says, for I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. Will I remember no more? So he's sitting. I told you he had something for anything you can come up with. You wanna condemn yourself? He said, well, you're going to have to do it because I ain't doing it. Yeah. I'm not doing it. He said he didn't come into the world to condemn the world, right? So he's sitting telling you the stuff that you putting on yourself or that you allowing the enemy. I didn't do that. So I have a problem with people always talking about, well, God did this and this is the way God wanted. That ain't what he said. That ain't what he said, right? Fear of failure. Fear of failure, right? I'm scared to pursue it because I might not get it. Well, you might just get it. It's like that what if thing, right? What if, what if I do and this happen? Well, what if you don't? What you got to lose? You don't have it already. You in pursuit of, you don't have it already. So the least you can do is put an effort towards, okay, God, is this a part of my purpose? And if it is, add it to me. If I'm supposed to pursue it, tell me to pursue it. Because if you tell me, I'm going after it. Amen. And the thing about it in here, sometimes you're afraid to ask, God, am I supposed to be pursuing that? So then you have these people come up here and they say, you need to get it together because guess what God got for you, right? Miriam, he got a house he want to give you, right? You know what she did? She wrote it down and she started to believe it and she started to do what was necessary. She started praying about it. She started sowing seeds towards it. That right there showed me that she was in faith for it, right? It wasn't too much longer. Next thing you know, she was standing up saying, y'all don't understand. Right? Y'all don't understand. God has blessed me so much. And the crazy part about it is she ain't been here that long. And I'm mad at myself. Because she came in with that pureness, right? And God said he had something for her. And boy, next thing you know, she had. I got some stuff that I ain't got yet. Right? Been here for a long time, right? It ain't Miriam's fault. It's mine. It's mine. It's my fault. It ain't Miriam's fault, but I'm rejoicing with her. I'm so happy she got her truck and her car, and I want her to tell me some more stuff that she wants because I want to watch it happen. Because it should do something for your spirit when you see her pursuing purpose and it's happening for her. Right? I talked to my friend Aaron, and I know how she wants the brand newest off the showroom floor Lexus, right? She has been in pursuit of it. She's been doing the right thing. And God said, hey, in time, I will give it to you, right? And each, I don't think she have a car for about a year and a half at most. Then she like, guess what I got? Guess what I got? I moved up another year. I moved up another 2 years. I moved up. And every time, is she getting closer and closer and closer to what she desired. God has a perfect plan for all of us. But what if she didn't feel like she was worthy of driving that Lexus, right? She was fearing that when she went to the lot, she said she almost left. She didn't almost leave because she was scared. She almost left because she wasn't getting what she wants, right? When you pursue a purpose and you understand the freedom that salvation gives you, you can go in and demand some stuff and say, you know what? I know what you want, but this is what I want. Yeah. That's just the way it is. You don't have to be subject to them. Because that car dealership, even though they employ some Christian people, good. But they still work on the world system. And God has a plan that can even rectify that, right? So fear of failure. 2 Corinthians 2:14 says, no, now thanks be unto God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ and make it manifest the salvation of his knowledge by us in every place. So he said, let me read that one time. It says that make manifest the savior of his knowledge by us in every place. So every time that we dispel that fear and go out and get what we want, you know what? We showing his knowledge. All right. We showing his ability. Amen. Somebody watching. Yeah. Somebody's watching. Don't ever think people ain't watching. Yeah. Right? Another one. Philippians 4:13 said, I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. What do you get strengthened by? His word. You got to know what he promised. You got to know. It says that we are destroyed because of a lack of knowledge, right? You get out there and can't get what you want because you don't even know that he said you can have it. It's a part of your covenant. People talking about healing. It's a part of your covenant. It ain't something it's something that was added to you. It ain't something you got to fight for.
Come on now.
You put your faith in him. And you tell your body to align itself, and it will do so. That simple. Put your faith in him. Understand what his salvation gave your body. It made it new. And when it don't want to act new, you command it to act new. Because it ain't supposed to act like this. Not up in hell. That's what I tell mine. Any little thing that come up, please. I go run it off. My body is well equipped. Yeah. People say, you ain't supposed to go run when you sick. I ain't sick. So I'm going to go out there and I'm going to prove it to my body. By the time I finish, ain't none of that there. Right? Amen. That's just the way it works. But see, you got to understand that you ain't subject to everything. And just because your body may show a symptom of something, that don't stop confessing you sick. Amen. You sick if you say you are. Even if you feel it, don't say it. Don't say it. It say you can speak blessings and curses out with the power of your tongue, right? So when you sit back and you say stuff, what have you created in your own life that's keeping you from your purpose? Right? What have you put before yourself? You built up walls for yourself. But one word can tear all that down. One word, understanding what has already been promised to you, right? Freely given. Another thing that may get you off focus, money and careers, right? I can't pursue purpose because, see, I got bills and I got this and I got that and I got this and I want this and I want that and I want this and I don't have enough and I don't have, the word talks about that. It talks about that. Matthew 6:33. Says, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be what? Added unto you. Maybe you ain't supposed to be focused on that. He'll just add it to you. Right? Deuteronomy 8 and 18. It says, but thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is he that giveth thee power to get wealth. Right? Give you power to get wealth. That he may establish his covenant. See, that's the problem right there. That's the problem right there. You want to get wealth to establish your covenant. Because I got to let you see the status that I have. Right? I got to sit back and be able to pat my chest and talk about, you know what? I did this. I went to school. I worked hard. I made the right deals. I did all of this. Right? But one thing I realized is that without purpose is still unfulfilling. It's still unfulfilling. We wonder why people with all the money in the world, they should be happy, but they're not. But they're not. Because the pursuit of happiness is not through wealth. Wealth make it easier. But life without purpose is unfulfilling. So no matter what you do, no matter who you marry, no matter how many cars you have, how many houses you have, how much time you spend at the beach, whatever your fantasy may be and where you want, what you want and what you want to have, you will walk around unfulfilled if you're not fulfilling purpose.
That's right.
If you don't attach yourself to God's will for your life, you will always be unfulfilled. And you will go around hurting people.
That's the truth.
Hurting people. And you know why you're hurting? Because you will have an unrealistic expectation of that person because they're supposed to fulfill something that only God can do. But you turn around and you hold it against them. You can't make me happy. Well, when it comes to that, I ain't supposed to. It's certain things that I ain't supposed to do. She got to get that from God. And then he helps me do the rest in my part.
Right?
That's the only way she's going to be fulfilled.
Amen. That's
right. I'm happy she has that understanding because she don't put me before God.
Amen.
Sorry. It don't happen. I'm happy because that mean I don't get the unrealistic expectation on me. Right? Certain things she don't even come to me about. She say, you know what? I was trusting God. And if I needed to, I would have brought it to you. How can I be mad at that? Right? But soon as she say it, guess what God make me want to do? Figure out what I can do for. That's just the way it is. I'm telling you. So what you have to realize, look, one of the last things that he showed me, he said, the biggest thing for most people and why they won't pursue purpose is the lack of control of their own life.
All right.
The lack of control of their own life, right? The lack of control of their own life. I want to control this. I got to understand the way I should be going. Can't nobody tell me what I want or what I need or what I need to do. And as much as I won't open my mouth and say that to God, but my actions say that exactly. Right? Co-pastor Patton is saying love is what love does, right? God is sitting back watching your love walk. And he's saying, I know you ain't brave enough to say it. God, I don't need you in this. I don't want you in this. This part I want to control myself. We talked about purpose-driven daily. So if you purpose-driven daily, that means you allowing, you opening the door for him to come in on a daily basis, get in the driver's seat, you get on the passenger side. Well, he likes to chauffeur us, so get in the back, right? And let him take you where you need to be going. And when you get to your destination, he say, all right, you can get out now, go handle that, right? Go get that, come on back, and we're going to go to the next thing, right? But no, we want to be the driver. I got driver's license. I don't need nobody to drive me nowhere. Right? Next thing you know, you ain't listening to the voice of God. We were on our way back from Orlando. Thank God that I got to take my family to Orlando for vacation. Right? My kids enjoyed it. My wife enjoyed it. My mother-in-law enjoyed it. I enjoyed it. I always enjoy seeing them enjoy our time away. Well, we were on our way back. And before we left the resort, we prayed. And I came against anything that would hinder us on our way back. Came against traffic jams and all that kind of stuff, right? Accidents, all that. So we driving, and my wife, you know, she likes to sleep. when she's driving. So she rides in the back and she rides the kids and her thing. She have a pillow and all that. And I have my second set of eyes. My mother-in-law rides in the front with me and she always helps me drive. That's the way it goes. So she ain't sleeping. She would doze a couple times, but then she'll wake up. Y'all right? Yeah, I'm good. That type of thing. I appreciate it. So we on our way back and we come off the turnpike, right? And was it? Yeah. Saw this, what is it? Russell Stover's Chocolate Factory, right? Now, we ain't got to rush to get back. We enjoying ourselves. So if we going to stop all places on the way back, cool, right? So she said, it's a couple of miles up the road. I just saw the sign, right? So we driving, and then we driving, and we not really paying attention. My mother-in-law dozes off a little bit. Next thing you know, she wakes up and she looks and she said, I think that's a sign right there. We must be closer. We said, this must be the exit. Just got off, right? Not knowing, because we didn't even get to see the sign real good. She just so happened we was passing, saw the Russell. Didn't know if that was the exit. Got off the exit. Stopped at the gas station. I said, I'm going to go ask this lady right here to see if this is the exit, right? Get out of the car, turn around and look. Traffic. Back up. Accident just happened soon as we got off. I'm talking about off the exit, pull into a gas station right off the exit, get open the door, traffic just go whoo. And the first thing we said is, we prayed for that.
Yeah. Amen.
You gotta understand, when you pray for something, he gonna do just what you ask.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it was up to us to acknowledge to each other. Because when nobody else there, to acknowledge each other. That was God right there.
Yeah.
When I tell you, right soon as we got off, the accident happened and the traffic was backed up. We went down, enjoyed ourselves, got all our chocolate sales and all this kind of stuff. Got back in the car. We was like, I wonder if there's another route that would skip us over this accident, get us around it. Is a way we can go, put it in a GPS, it would let us right back to the interstate where we were going. Got back there, it wasn't a traffic jam nowhere. It was as clear as can be.
Yeah.
See, that may not mean nothing to you, but I'm telling you, when you ask God for something, you got to understand that he's going to give you exactly what you asked for. I was expecting not to be caught up in an accident. And I'm trying to tell you, the way that happened, we would have been right in the middle of it. Not that we would have been a part of it. We would have been right in the middle of it. And we came against that. And thank God for the love of chocolate. We like chocolate. So we got off. You got me? So I'm telling you, that's when I tell you, you do not want to be in control. You have, each one of us can sit back and talk about the times where we've been in control. And you know what? He had to recover us because we did the driving. You won't tell me that I messed it up and he told me not to, but you know. So I ain't asking you to point at the person next to you. I'm talking about search yourself. You know the times when you was driving and you didn't allow him to. And the bad part, the good part about God is he be sitting right over there still the whole time you driving saying, turn. Turn. Don't go that way. Don't go that way. Get off this lane. Go over there. Hey, don't even go over there. Come back this way. Turn around and go back the other way. He be sitting there the whole time saying this stuff. But because we're not pursuing purpose, we can't hear. We can't hear. Now, one of the last things I want to tell you is in your own time, because I think it's something that we should get to our children really early. Pursuing purpose.
Yeah.
Because if I can get Elisha to understand that him being a singer may be a part of his purpose. Maybe a part of his purpose. But the singer he think he supposed to be, that ain't it. That ain't it. So no matter what he say, we gonna keep on putting him up here and he gonna exercise his gift. I was just in the car talking to him just the other day when we was riding after he got out of school. And I was explaining to him what his name means. And there's a reason why you have the name Elisha. And the prophetic gift is on you, whether you want it to be or not. I understand at this time you may not understand it, but in due time you will understand it. And I'm going to keep on telling you and talking to you about it until you understand it.
Yeah.
and I am not, because it say train them up in the way that they should go.
That's right.
So the way that he want to go, it's just him being young. It's just him being young.
Right?
But that's not an excuse. Because he has a great understanding. My son is extremely smart. And if you ever had a conversation with him, he don't sound like a 9-year-old. Most people don't even think he's 9. He's 9 years old. He has a clear understanding. He understands who God is and what God is, right? But sometimes it takes his parents and his grandparents and the people around him to say, no, 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 no. We're going to steal you right on back over here. That's just the way it is. And it don't just go for him. It go for my daughter, too. And it should go for your son and your daughter. Because if you don't understand what it is that God has placed in your child, maybe it's something you need to be getting together. Get it together. Understand, because it's up to us to help them. Why would he give them to us and say, you know what? We just going to leave this responsibility to pastor them. They spend more time with you than they do with them.
Amen.
So what do you see in them? And when you see something in them, tell them what you see. Tell them what you see. So we don't hesitate. His mama quickly tell him, oh, what you thinking about, that ain't it. That ain't it. So you might well kill that. You might well, you forget that. All right, that right there, you don't listen to no more. Since it got that much influence on you, that's over with. That's over with. We take that away. That's done. That's done. And if you can't do without it, that show you that you can't control that. That's it. That's it. You can't have that. And the more you mature, like we tell him, the more he mature, right, he will understand, right? But I don't want him subject to nothing that ain't godly. Nothing. So that's the thing. And I'm going to keep on giving it to him. And my daughter gets the same treatment. She may not have the name or something, but we understand that it's on her. They were born in here. They were born into a house of purpose. They don't have a choice. So why you give them a choice? Why you give them a choice? We don't give them a choice. Why you give them a choice? When the youth is going on, when we up in here ministering to them, we ministering purpose to them. We ain't worried about none of that other stuff.
Amen.
So we trying to help you. Help them. Because we in this together. Right? One, y'all should take the time and study the life of Joseph. Genesis 37 through about 43 chapter. Right? This is somebody that had all kind of adversity come before him, but he never lost focus.
Yeah.
In 37, it talks about how he was the son of Jacob, and he had brothers, and they despised him because he was his dad's child of an old age, and his dad loved him, and he gave him a coat that proved it. Had a bunch of colors, and it was pretty, and they couldn't stand it. Right? They did not like it. Right? They envied him. Right? So he went in and he had a dream. He had two dreams and he shared it with them. And when he shared the dreams with them and his father and them, they both had a problem saying, you mean to tell me we're going to be subject to you? Right? He didn't understand it because they didn't understand it. Right? Okay. So then his brother despised him so much, they decided that they were going to get rid of him. We're going to get rid of him. Some said, let's kill him and tell him that a beast devoured him. Right? One of the brothers like, no, don't do no harm to him. Right? They ignored him, set a trap for him, put him in a pit. People came by. They sold him to him. I'm paraphrasing. Sold it to him. Right? Took his coat because, you know, he wasn't going nowhere without that coat.
Yeah.
Right? Because that meant something.
Yeah.
That talked about who he was and his status.
Yeah.
Right? You say what you want, but it's a reason why you should dress up and represent who you are. Don't be ashamed of who you are, right? No matter who despises it, no matter who hates it, that's their problem. But it's a problem when God is trying to show forth for the people that is looking, and you worry about the one person that's hating. That's a problem, right? So they got up, and they set the trap for him. They sold him. They killed a beast, dipped his, put blood all over it, took it back to his father and said, the beast got him, right? But he never lost focus. He got sold. He got put into the Pharaoh's house. Right? When they set the trap for him, he was 17. They talked about how godly he was at 17.
Come on.
Then he got in Pharaoh's house, and they say everything that he put his hands to, God blessed. That means in Pharaoh's house, he was still representing God. Or how would they see it?
Yeah.
He represented God so well that Pharaoh started saying, I'm going to give you all my stuff. Shoot, I see the blessings on you, yeah. Right? So I need some of that, so I'm going to let you take care of all my stuff. Because I know it's going to prosper if it's in your hand.
Yeah.
That means no matter, he was a Hebrew boy in Pharaoh's house, right?
In the palace.
In the palace. And he was representing Christ.
Yeah.
You can't tell me he wasn't, because they saw it. His actions spoke about the God that was in him.
Yeah.
Even in a place that probably that wasn't proper. But God's going to protect him, because he had a plan. Because he was pursuing purpose. Even purpose, that's one thing. Even if you don't understand it, always pursue it. Stay the course. Just because you may not understand every prophetic word that comes to you, stay on it. He hold on to those dreams. The dreams that he had that he told his brother and his dad know about, he hold on to it, right? So then, that didn't work. The enemy come up, sends that woman. The king's wife come over telling him to lie with her, right? He sat back and he said, why would I do that? The king believes in me. He has placed everything he has in his hand. That would be crazy for me to do that. I'm in a perfect position.
Amen.
In a place that I ain't even supposed to be in. Right?
Yes,
so he gonna mess up a great thing for the pleasures of a moment. How many times have we messed up for the pleasures of a moment and mess up something good? Because you can't control yourself. That's a problem. Right? So he tell her no. She trapped him one time. Grab his garment. He was like, you can have it. He came up out of it. He left it with her. He was like, she had his coat. He was like, okay. He was out of there. Nothing's going to hold him in that sinful spot. Because he didn't want to disappoint the king or God. So many times we worry about the king don't see it, but God see you. So he left it with her. So she took that back to the king. Went to the servant, the guards around there was like, look what he done. He tried to lie with me, and I started to scream loud, and he ran. That's why I got his garment. So she took that to the king. The king was so furious, he put him in prison. But when God is on you, I don't care what the situation may be, he going to always protect you, and he going to always have a way of escape. Right? Always have a way of escape. So he gets in prison, and he finds favor with the person that's over the prison. You know why? Because he was still pursuing purpose. He was still letting God shine through him. And they was like, he may be down here, but he ain't like none of us, right? So then the king had a problem with his butler and his chef, right? So he got a problem with them, so he sticks them in prison, right? Now y'all got to go to. Put them in prison. They have dreams. They come back and they tell Joseph about the dream. He said, come to me. And they said, you can interpret my dream. He said, God interpret. He said, God, read it. He said, God interpret. So when he was saying, he'll use me, he was giving God the glory no matter what, because he didn't want credit. Right? So he turned around. The chef told him. The butler told him his dream. He told him what it meant, that he would be put back in place. The chef gave him his dream. He told him he would be going to be killed and hung from a tree, right? He told him, he interpreted the dream. Just like they said, he told the chef, he told the butler, when you get back in place, don't forget me. Remember me. Don't forget me. Right? I don't care how long it takes. God going to always have somebody there for you. He going to always have somebody there. For your sake, I'm telling you, he would not let us lose. Right? Time went through. Pharaoh had a dream. Went to everybody trying to get them to interpret. Nobody could. The butler remembered then. It's this boy that you got down in prison. Right? He had been there after the butler left. He had been in prison 2 more years since after that. He had forgot. But when that dream time, because he had perfect timing. God had perfect timing. He told him, It's a guy in the prison that you got down there. He interpreted my dream, right? Pharaoh sent for him. He interpreted the dream, right? Mm-hmm. Pharaoh told him in this time, told him it was going to be 7 years of great and 7 years of famine. He told him, okay, since you understand that, in this 7 years, we putting you over everything,
yeah.
Right? To prepare us for the 7 years of famine, right? Lo and behold, he was in place for his same brothers that sold him.
Yeah, just like the dream.
Just like the dream told him. They was talking about, are we going to have to bow down to you and all that? That ain't what it meant. God wasn't that what it meant, but he had a plan. So anytime you pursuing purpose, know that God always has the perfect plan for you. He can never go wrong, but you can. So if you stay focused on what he wants for you, if you pursue purpose daily, you can never lose. Hope y'all receive some.